In this video, we'll walk through how to create a feature service and layer using the PI Integrator for Esri ArcGIS. This is going to allow us to expose this PI system data to the Esri ArcGIS platform. I have already made sure that my PI Integrator for Esri ArcGIS, as well as the Esri ArcGIS GeoEvent Processor data stores and certificates are all configured. Additionally, my asset framework is ready too. This was shown in the previous video. I will bring these locomotive assets, which are based off of the same AF element template, and their attributes into the Esri ArcGIS platform as point geometries. I'll start by going to the configuration portal. I have logged on to the PI Integrator for Esri ArcGIS configuration portal, the URL right here, and go ahead and create a service. I'll give it a name and description. The stream server is for the data flow, and the display server is for the integration with PI Coresight, and I'm going to keep both checked and hit create. The next thing I'll need to do is create a layer. So I'm going to create a layer and give this a name and description as well. And continue. Now I'll need to configure the data source. So I'm going to select the name of the PI AF server, as well as the AF database. Remember, the AF database was real company, and the template that I am interested in is the locomotive template. There's also the option to select a search route, and this is something that can be helpful if you're only bringing in a subset of the elements. In this case, rail company is the highest element, and I'm interested in bringing in all the elements based off of the locomotive template for the entire AF database, so I'll just leave the search route at that and hit continue. Here we're going to configure the template attribute fields, and these are which AF attributes from the elements, as well as some element information that we want to bring into the Esri ArcGIS platform. I'm interested in bringing in all the AF attributes, so I'll leave those checked. And there's also a couple function choices that I need to make. For the point geometry, I need to specify the X and Y, and you can see that because of the names are latitude and longitude, this is already auto-defaulted and selected the function as X and Y. If your attributes are named something different, you'll still need to just go ahead and make the selection manually using the appropriate dropdown. And the last function choice that we'll need to make is for the key, and that's that unique key. And I mentioned earlier that I'm going to be doing that off of the element name, so I'm going to specify that as the key here. And then I can continue. And lastly, the geometry type is point because I've specified that X and Y coordinate. And also for spatial reference, I'm going to stick with the default, which is the World Geodetic System 84, which is the most widely used coordinate system. At this point, it's now going to offer to open the Connect to ArcGIS Platform wizard. And I'm going to do this option because I want the wizard to help me automatically create the feature service and layer on the Esri ArcGIS platform side. And I've hit next after confirming that I've met the requirements. And in this case, I'm going to be using the ArcGIS Online account that we used earlier. And remember, this account has been added as a data store on the GeoEvent processor. And so it will create a feature service with this name and a service layer as part of that feature service with this name on the Esri ArcGIS Online environment. So the feature service has been successfully created. And the next steps are the items on the GeoEvent processor. This is the GeoEvent processor, and again, the administrator credentials that are specific to the GeoEvent processor. That was successful, so I can go ahead and go next. And these are the input, output, and geoservices that it will create. By default, you can see it appends PI Geo to the beginning, and simply for the sake of being able to easily identify these items on the GeoEvent Processor Manager, I'm going to go ahead and add my initials to the beginning. You can also see this checkbox for Use HTTPS Secure. This specifies whether the data is going to be transmitted securely. It is important to note that using HTTPS does require a security configuration on the GeoEvent processor. So if that has been taken care of on the GeoEvent processor, you can use this option. If that has not been done, you would have to uncheck this box to use the HTTP transport. This has been done, so I'm going to use HTTPS and create. And it has created all three of those items, and then it will say that when the service is created, it'll report done. So I can hit next, and this finishes the process. We can confirm that all the necessary items are successfully created and look at the data flow. By first starting here in the configuration portal, we can see the service and layer that were created, and the stream server, we can look at the data flow. We can then look at the GeoEvent Processor Manager. I'm going to switch to services. Here we can see that the GeoEvent service was created, and we can also see the corresponding input and output by scrolling down. Alternatively, we can use these inputs, GeoEvent services, and outputs to look at each individual list. And then finally, in Esri ArcGIS Online, I can navigate to my content and see the rolling stock feature layer that was just created. Let's look at this feature layer using the ArcGIS Online map option. And we can load the feature layer, going to add and search for layers. To make it easier to find, I'm going to look at my content. And I can see the rolling stock feature layer, and I'll go ahead and add that. Can see all my locomotives appear pretty close together, so I can zoom to. And within this Esri map, there are a lot of options for customization. For example, I can use the base map option to switch to a different type. If I want to look at the railroads with respect to these locomotives, I can browse Esri map layers. And add the USA railroads to the map. Right now, by default, all the locomotives appear as this green box. And that doesn't necessarily represent to me what a locomotive is. And that's something that I can also configure. I can change the symbols. And you'll notice over here, I can use a single symbol, or I can even use multiple symbols if I want to change colors based off of attributes like how fast the locomotive is moving. In my case, I'm going to change the symbol to something that represents a locomotive. And beyond just the location on the map, if I click on one of these locomotives, I can see all the information that I was interested in bringing in this pop-up here. I can change the refresh rate that the locomotives update their position and information as well if I modify this refresh interval. So in this case, I'm going to refresh the layer every 0.05 minutes. And with this, I can watch as these assets move in real time, and they're going to blink every time that they update. And one great customization option that is available is, in addition to being able to click on one of these and look at the attribute information, I mentioned that there's an integration possible with PI Coresight. And we can use PI Coresight to look at the historical data as well. To be able to configure this, we're going to configure a pop-up for this particular layer, the locomotives. And we'll add an image, and this is where the information in the configuration portal is needed. So I'll give this a title as Explore in PI Coresight. And for the URL, I can get this information from this layer's display server. These images are available, and I'm going to use this middle image. That's added to the URL, and the link is the action that you want it to do. In my case, I want it to open an ad hoc PI Coresight display. So I'll use this. And then save pop-up. And now when I have one of these selected, I look down and have the Explore in PI Coresight option available. And this opens the ad hoc PI Coresight trend where all the attributes have been added here. And I can take a look at different options and see what the historical data looks like as well, not just the last value. With that, I'll go back and I'm going to have the option to save and share this map. Keep in mind, this is just the Esri ArcGIS Online map. There are other Esri ArcGIS client tools, for example, Operations Dashboard, where you can combine these type of custom maps, and the maps within Operations Dashboard won't have this flash update, but they can update more smoothly, and you can incorporate other widgets like charts and gauges. So this is just really the beginning of getting your PI system data into the Esri ArcGIS platform. There's two other tools that are available that I want to mention. Looking in the configuration portal under tools, you can see that there is the asset extractor. And this asset extractor is going to read assets within a feature layer and then add them to your PI asset framework. So this is a really good option for Esri ArcGIS users who might have all their assets defined in ArcGIS and are just getting started with the PI system, so they don't have an asset framework built out. And finally, there's also the PI Integrator for Esri ArcGIS GeoEvent Manager, which is available from the OSIsoft Tech Support website. If you are experiencing any issues with the GeoEvent Processor data inputs failing while the data is streaming and it doesn't provide an indication, this service can be installed to monitor the data inputs and restart them if this problem occurs. With that, That is how you can create your feature, service, and layer, bringing your PI system data into the Esri ArcGIS platform.